Well, I was a Fulbright Scholar in 1951-52 and went to Rome. And sometime, I was probably around the middle of the year, a friend of mine from St. Louis, Missouri, where I was born, came to Rome. A big surprise to me. He looked me up. I was glad to see him. His name was Robert Isaacson. We called him Bobby. He came to Rome because some of his friends were there. I never found out whether they planned it, but there was a group of young men who met in Rome and they were going around, and Bobby introduced me to them. One of those guys was James Merrill. And I had no idea who he was. I had never read his poetry. He just seemed like a nice guy. And for some utterly unknown reason, we bonded instantly. And we kind of, with an off the cards understanding, we made an agreement. He would teach me a lot about poetry, current poetry and historical poetry, if I would teach him about the visual art in the history of representation. As a Fulbright, I had to take some graduate courses at the University of Rome, La Sapienza, and I was taking one course with Leonello Venturi, the son of an even more famous Adolfo Venturi, the founders of art history in Italy. And he heard that I had done some work with Panofsky on the iconography of the infant St. John the Baptist. And he immediately said, oh, you should go to San Giovanni Decolato. So we took ourselves there. After I had made an appointment, because the place is always closed, it is dedicated to St. John the Baptist, mainly because St. John the Baptist was beheaded. And this place had a confraternity that was serving prisoners who were condemned to death. They had to fulfill the spiritual needs of the condannati and make sure that their bodies were buried in a Christian fashion. So we waited in the church and we were looking around at the places filled with stucco work and painted stucco and 100 paintings and so on. But the altarpiece is what caught your eye. And that turned out to be either by or under the supervision of Giorgio Vasari himself, the great writer, who was also a terrific painter. But this altarpiece took my breath away because the body, St. John had been, it was the beheading of St. John. That's what the subject was. It has all a number of other kind of peculiarities, but his head had already been cut off and was being held up by a kind of Herculean executioner, semi-nude. And his body was crumpled in the foreground with his neck facing forward and blood was spouting out of his neck. In a kind of super anatomical way, there were three different, at any rate, I nearly fainted. I had never seen anything like that. So I should have been warned by that altarpiece what we were going to see in the oratorio. At any rate, there I was supposed to be explaining things to Jimmy and I was speechless. So we walked into the oratorio and of course, all of the paintings in there are also high mannerism, very contorted figures, huge bodies thrown here and there, kind of marvelous, I know now. But at that point, we were all just staggered with surprise. And wouldn't you know that the one painting in there that no one has ever figured out who did it is the beheading of St. John, and the motif of the spouting head was even exaggerated. It was facing forward and the blood was coming right straight at you. I kept saying, well, this is not what I'm used to Jimmy. And so we all had a good laugh, because all of a sudden, with all my carrying on about this, that, and the other thing, and why you should look here and there, I was speechless for a couple of days. Well, then it turned out that Jimmy was taking note of absolutely everything. And in the one novel that he wrote, which is called The Seraglio, he gave me one of the characters. I am Jane in that. And he says that I'm working on Alessandro Allori, which was true. I was doing a little work on him. And he said that I was working on Allori because all the good painters were already taken. And that was what was left over for me. And that I was always walking around and carrying a bundle of note cards and notebooks and so on, until one day he found that I got caught in front of behind the high altar when Mass started. And I had to find my way out of that. He describes all of this in his novel. So I think that was his revenge somehow for the speechless time. So I was alone in Cambridge, because Irving was at Harvard, and Jimmy came up to Boston from time to time, but one time he came up with his father, and they invited me to dinner at a hotel where his father, who at that point wasn't married, but he was going with a lady who would have loved to be married with him. And they drank like fish. And I am not used to that. I never was, and still am not. But you know, there was one martini after another before any food came, and we all got rip-roaring drunk. I mean, there's not a nice word for it. At any rate, I think Jimmy got up to go to the little boys' room at some point, and Charles Merrill said to me, "Why hasn't your son married you?" He was actually drunk, but dead serious. He would have loved Jimmy to marry. And I said, "Mr. Merrill, I am married." And he said, "Oh, well, we can fix that." It was a remarkable experience. So when Jimmy came back, nobody said anything about that, but it was our little secret. You know, I'm not sure I told Hammer that story, but I think that the father said that because it was true. Jimmy took me out one night in New York. Now, can I remember any of the names involved? His great, great friend at Amherst, who was also a writer. And I remembered it to write it in my own memoir, but now I can't think of it. At any rate, he took me out one night in order to show me to this young man. And for some unknown reason, we went to some kind of a diner for a sandwich. I mean, it was very kind of low class. At any rate, I didn't realize what was going on, but Jimmy was showing me to this guy to get an okay from him. So my sense was that I didn't pass muster at that point. But that's what it had been about. He was like an octopus with tentacles out everywhere.
Yes.
Maybe the reverse of an octopus. They were all coming toward him.